have a good time. Put a smile on your face, yeah. KB Cam and Elation Radio. Even brighten your day and help you through the night. Bring you good music. KB Cam and Elation Radio. And here's your host.
Hi, I'm Dr. Jerry Green. Welcome to Open Mic with Bishop Ernest E. Richard and Company. We have an awesome show lined up for you tonight as the Bishop tackles kingdom issues and current events But first, let's receive First Lady Sharon Richard with her faithful financial moments. Good evening, First Lady.
Good evening, Jerry. This is Sharon Richard with your faithful financing moment. One of the biggest expenditures that we all have is the cost of food. As food costs have continued to rise, many have struggled to stay within their food budget. There are some things that you can do to save on food costs. Number one, buy bulk when possible. There are certain items that can be stored for long periods of time that are healthy for you, such as rice, beans, and pasta. When you see a great sale on these products, consider buying in bulk, or if you can get a great price at a club store, it may save you money on these products over the course of the year. Number two, take note of which stores tend to sell certain items at a lower price. I have gotten to the point where I will only buy certain items from certain stores. So I may visit one store for certain items 1 week and then go to another store where I prefer to purchase the other items. Of course, always keep an eye on items that you purchase that may be on sale at any of the stores, but you should get a sense for which store in your area generally has cheaper prices. One recent study indicated that simply by shopping at less expensive stores, the average family could save $5,000 per year. Number three, avoid spur-of-the-moment grocery shopping. We all have a tendency to buy more than we need during unplanned shopping trips because we are walking the aisles to see what looks good. It is best to develop a weekly meal plan and the corresponding shopping list that you take with you to the grocery store. How often do you find that you purchased an item from the grocery store only to discover that you already had the item at home? Additionally, the weekly meal plan will help you to take full advantage of leftovers. Perhaps leftover baked chicken would be perfect in a casserole the next day or on a salad. Developing a weekly meal plan will help your family to eat healthier and help you to save money because you purchased only what was needed. You are also less likely to make the last-minute decision to eat out, which would only be more costly. You should also minimize paying for the store to cut up your items. Today, when you go to the grocery store, you notice many items are partially prepped for you. For example, you can buy shredded cheese, chicken parts, sliced vegetables, and chopped onions. Rather than buying those chicken parts, buy the whole chicken. It is cheaper, and you can bake the chicken for one meal and then take the remains to make a wonderful chicken soup for a future meal. I realize that we all purchase these items to save time. However, where possible, consider taking the longer route to save the money. Investing in a good food processor to help you complete these tasks would be cheaper than continually paying the grocery store to do it for you. We all must make that trip to the grocery store, but it does not have to blow your budget, and it may actually be an opportunity for you to save a little extra money. This is Sharon Richard with your faithful financing moment. Up next, Nina Taylor with your gospel news, followed by Open Mic with the Bishop with your host, Bishop Ernest E. Richard, Jr. And tonight, it's Ladies Night, so get ready for a fantastic discussion led by Pastor Anna Henderson and Elder Lauren Brown.
How you doing, everybody? I'm Nina Taylor. Here's this week's gospel news. Monica Lisa Stevenson. She is a minister and contemporary gospel artist with a muscular voice, a strong foundation in traditional church music. The Atlanta-based singer and songwriter came along in 2009 with her album Finally in God's Time, a self-issued debut album that led to a pair of stellar award nominations. Her subsequent recordings include Live in Atlanta and Kanoth, the acoustic documentary. Billboard charting sets released respectively in 2013 and 2016. I'm Not Ashamed, a galvanizing single that topped the gospel airplay chart in 2021. The triumphant It Is Well followed in 2023. Stevenson was born Monica Felicia Bowen, was encouraged in both faith and music by her parents, who raised her and her five younger siblings in Wetumpka, Alabama. After moving to Atlanta, she and Derek Stevenson, her husband and musical director, joined the New Life International Family Church and the Gospel Music Workshop of America. She became a licensed minister in 1997, establishing the group Lisa Stevenson and Company. Her debut album, Finally in God's Time, was self-released in 2009 and earned her a Stellar Award nomination in the categories of Best New Artist and Traditional Female Vocalist of the Year. After an appearance in the movie Madea's Big Happy Family and tours of Italy and Switzerland, Stevenson released Live in Atlanta, which rose to number 14 on Billboard's Gospel Albums chart in 2013. Stevenson had another big year in 2021. She contributed to National Geographic's anthology series Genius Aretha by recording a vocal lip sync by the actress who portrayed Sammy Bryant and her single I'm Not Ashamed. It topped the Gospel Airplay charts. Stevenson returned in 2023 with the song It Is Well. Detroit, Michigan-based gospel artist Paul Porter was a member of the Stellar-nominated group The Christian Heirs, who were active through most of the late 80s and the first half of the 2000s. As a solo artist, Porter, who has been singing since the age of 3, debuted on the Light label in 2008 with the album A New Day, which featured an appearance from fellow Michigander Rance Allen, as well as one from Harvey Watkins Jr., and peaked at number 21 on Billboard's Gospel Albums chart. Porter later signed to Motown Gospel, where he released Free in 2014, another set of gospel songs that combine traditional and contemporary sounds. It reached number 33 on the gospel album charts. Porter has also collaborated with the likes of the Jackson Southerners, the Williams Brothers, and the Canton Spirituals. This lady is a young, passionate, contemporary gospel performer. Her name is Keela Richardson. She is known for her dynamic praise and worship music. She initially gained widespread attention competing on season 9 of BET's Sunday Best. In 2019, she hit the gospel charts with her single, So Good. Born and raised in Pensacola, Florida, Richardson grew up singing in the church where her parents were pastors. By her teens, she was performing locally along with leading worship services. In 2015, a video of Richardson and her friends singing the Walls group's Hold On went viral and helped build interest in her as a singer. She released the single Believe on Doug Williams' Blackberry Records in 2018. The following year, she gained even wider visibility as she competed on BET's Sunday Best Talent Competition, where she finished in the final four. After leaving the show, Richardson released her smash hit single, So Good. Happy birthday to everyone who are celebrating their birthdays in this month of September. If you are a September birthday celebrity, you share your birthday with Idris Elba, Will and Jada Smith, Ben Carson, Calvin Johnson, Lauren Daigle, Mercy Chinwo, actor Keanu Reeves, Sissy Houston, Johnny Mathis, and singer Marilyn McCoo. Here's this week's Top 10 Gospel Songs. Number 10, Thank You from James Greer and Company featuring Morette Brown Clark. 9, Revival, Jules Judah. 8, It's Working, Todd Delaney featuring Hezekiah Walker. 7, Great God, Demetrius West and Jesus Promoters. 6, I Believe, Jacqueline Carr. 5, Still Alright, Blessed, Erica Campbell. 4, Lord Do It For Me, Zacardi Cortez. 3, Heaven by Anthony David and Algebra Brissett. Number 2, Down from Number 1, All Things from Kirk Franklin, which means our new number 1 song comes from Brian Courtney Wilson, Always Peace. Well, that's your top 10 songs and this week's gospel news. I'm Nina Taylor. Let's get back to more great gospel music on this great station. Hello, I'm Nina Taylor. Welcome to Open Mic with Bishop Ernest E. Richard and Company. This show tackles kingdom issues and current events from a biblical perspective. Now, let's join Bishop and Company for today's discussion. Good evening, Bishop.
And good evening to you, Miss Nina Taylor. So happy everybody could be with us today. Well, today I am going to step back because, as Sister Richard said, it is ladies' night, and I'm just excited and anticipating in what they're going to talk about tonight. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking today. I just want to give this mic over to those two who are going to handle whatever they're going to do. I'm talking about none other than Pastor Anna Henderson and Elder Lauren Bishop Brown. Good evening, ladies.
Good evening, good evening.
Good evening, Bishop.
Well, I am releasing the reins. I'm not in the driver's seat, so wherever you're going to go, somebody better jump behind the steering wheel because the car is still rolling. I'm moving out the way.
All right, we will do that. We will do that. Good evening. This is Ladies Night. We thank you for the space, Bishop. We are coming together as women of the word, women who are of faith, and women who have been in this journey for a while. And Pastor Henderson and I have been able to not only learn of each other, but learn of different things in the word and be able to share the word with other people. And that's our goal. We want to make sure that we're giving the word, but also discussing current events and issues that affect our walk and affect the kingdom. And Pastor Henderson, if you could give us a brief synopsis of who you are and where you're from and all that great stuff, I would really appreciate it.
Amen, amen. Good evening to our listening audience tonight. Amen, you're listening. Amen to Ladies Night tonight. Amen, amen, amen. My name is Pastor Anna Henderson from Indianapolis, Indiana. Amen. With my pastor, Sister Jefferson. Amen. And I am just excited about being a servant for the Lord Jesus Christ. I praise God for the
Amen.
Work that he's doing here in Indy. And I just praise God for being a part of this panel tonight. And I'm looking forward to this discussion on Ladies Night. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Beautiful. I'm Elder Lauren Bishop Brown. I'm from Agape Christian Center here in New Haven, Connecticut, where our pastor is Aaron J. Moody and our apostle Willa Moody. And I'm just grateful for the opportunity to come together and fellowship, not only with my sisters, but also, you know, gleaning from them, learning from them. And our guest, our first, very first guest is our own Pastor Pamela Teague. She's from Basileia Ministry here in Hamden, Connecticut, where the pastor is Dr. Walter J. Teague. And I would just like for her to open up her mic and tell us where you're from and what you're about and how you just love, love, love serving the Lord and being in the Word. And then after that, I'll have Pastor Henderson pray us in.
Good evening,
Amen.
Everybody. It's a pleasure to be on the line tonight. My name is Pamela Teague. I am the assistant pastor at Basileia Outreach Ministry, as Elder Brown stated, located in Hamden, Connecticut. We're there. I serve as the assistant pastor to my husband, Dr. Walter J. Teague, and also run the women's ministry and the community outreach. My passion is to help in the community, especially women, young women that are out there raising children by themselves or may have even been asked to leave their homes and don't know how to properly raise their children or raise them in the Lord or, you know, do those kind of things such as budgeting, such as balancing a thick book and savings and things like that. And also my desire is to minister to the young, to women in the church of all ages in general, just to bring them together to fellowship and encourage one another, to help us in the Lord, to strengthen us, to encourage.
Amen.
You know, and just to build us up. And to just to help on our journey and growing in the Word and growing in the Lord in the body of Christ.
Amen. Amen. Beautiful. All right, Pastor Henderson, if you would pray us in and then we will start our conversation and our dialogue.
Hallelujah. 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 Thanks. Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for this gathering tonight. We thank you, Lord, how you're for the women of God tonight. We thank you for each listener that's listening in on tonight. We thank you, Lord, that something's going to be said tonight that's going to encourage the hearts of your people. Something's going to be said tonight to how you take somebody to a higher plateau in their relationship with you tonight. Father God, have your way tonight. And Lord, we give you the praise, we give you the glory, we give you the honor. We thank you for this platform, and we thank you, Lord God, for what you're doing. Have your way tonight, and we give your name the praise, the glory, and all the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen. All right, well, then my first question is, Pastor Pam, what made you really, really come to feel that there was a need for an outreach ministry for the women, and how did you first begin it?
Okay. When we first started, when I first started the women's ministry, it came about actually in my home in the kitchen where I was talking to one of my good friends, Judy Dixon, and we were discussing, you know, things in the church and the women in the church, and she just began to share with me about being in the church and still feeling lonely, still being, you know, lonely.
Wow.
Where, you know, where sometimes, you know, it's not easy for people to make friends in the church, you know, or sometimes you come in and you just come to church and go home, hear the word and go home. You don't really fellowship.
Amen.
You feel out of place. Some do it because they shy. Some do it just because they don't know you, so they're not going to be the first one to say something to you and everything.
Okay.
At that time, I think I hadn't been at Agape very long at that time, so I really understood where she was coming from and felt some of the same things that she was feeling. So after that, I just began to pray, you know, and pray about it, and it just stuck with me. I just couldn't get it, you know, I was waking up to it, going to bed to it, just throughout the day, just
thinking about it.
And then, so, you know, the Lord just put on my heart one day just to have a women's fellowship. Let's just get all the women together who was willing to come together and gather, just to really start out just by introducing ourselves to each other, you know, and in that, and the first one that was held at my house in the kitchen, and the Lord moved mightily.
Awesome.
Right there.
Amen.
And, you know, where people began to share things that they never shared before, that they were just holding in. People shared stuff that were heavy on their hearts and stuff. And at that point, I think it was the Lord spoke through Elder Janet Brown, and he said that this was going to be like a hospital for the women, a place where they could
call Amen.
And that whatever was said there and whatever was done at these fellowships, we're going to stay there. So we didn't have fear about the things that we were talking about, because, you know, sometimes we just hold stuff in because we don't want people to know certain things, or, you know, we feel shame about some certain things about how we feel, how we're feeling, and things like that. So it really was birthed out of that, and we just began starting to gather once a month at the Women's Fellowship, and I can't say first it started out with a few, because a lot of people, they really showed their support at the first one, and we were in the living room, we were in the kitchen, we were in my den, that many people just came out.
Amen.
Came out, they gathered.
Yeah.
So we just moved it to the church, and within that, I mean, I've seen so many hurt people being delivered.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen. That's the goal. Amen.
Yes. And so many people being set free. And well, you didn't have to be ashamed of whatever it was that you were talking about, because we prayed every month, Sister Judy and I prayed every month on a topic on what we were going to talk about. Now, sometimes
Amen.
The Lord
Amen.
Didn't give us, you know, we just didn't have a specific topic. And so
Amen.
We didn't cancel because we didn't have a topic. We just went and let the Lord have his way. You know, I just surrendered
Amen.
It to the Lord. We had prayer. It was like, okay, God, I don't know what we're doing it from here, but it's in your hands. You know, you can use
yes.
me as
Amen.
A vessel, you know, or use us as a vessel for whatever it is that you want to talk about, because you know who's going to be there, and you know what's the need of those people, of the women that were going
right.
to be there. So sometimes it was just a surprise, but every single time I must say the Lord moved in those
Amen.
Services.
Amen.
You know.
Amen. And I can even recall
that
I don't believe I was there.
The need and an importance, and the importance
uh-huh.
of women's ministry.
You know, now I don't think I was at the first one in your home, but I know that to watch it go from the monthly meetings and then to go to the, I guess, seminars that you were able to host, and just
mm-hmm.
to see the way that the Lord was faithful, because you guys were
mm-hmm.
faithful, and also because the move of the Holy Spirit was easier to obtain and easier to get in that flow, because you guys were praying and in the Word and
yes.
giving us the Word. And I found that it was a drawing card, because for me, there were certain things that, as a young married woman, first time I was married, you know, you just didn't know what to expect. And then, as you
mm-hmm.
said, sometimes you're not able to speak up. Number one, it may be because of fear, it may be because of shame, but also it may be because some people come out of verbally abusive relationships and they may not
mm-hmm.
be able to speak up. But the way in which the Lord allows you to open up the forum for the women to come in, not only receive a level of love, but a level of respect, a level of confidentiality, and a level of we're here to support you. That's what I found was very, very moving, and also
exactly.
full of sisterhood. You know, I didn't
yes.
feel like we had to be in competition. I didn't feel like we had to dress a certain way. I did feel charged to, you know, get in the Word, to know a little bit more, so that I knew what I was working with, so I knew what I had. And that came not
mm-hmm.
only from the ministry, but also from the fellowship with you and Sister Judy and Sister Stephanie. And it's amazing, because sitting here now, I guess I could say, Pastor Pam, maybe 40 years later? Yeah, about 40, because I came to Agape in 87. And it's like
mm-hmm.
to understand how much the Word was valued then, how much you guys have poured into the women through the Word, through the seminars, through also, you know, food baskets, also, you know, the gift bags and things of that nature. It has shown so much love and consistency that it allows us to be more free, not only in coming to the ministry, but coming together as women, because I find sometimes that we as women, we're in competition. And we may not say it, but sometimes, you know, you feel like, well, you know, she's got this or she's got that. And we have to, I think, put ourselves in remembrance and say, you know, it's not about a competition, number one. And I appreciate
yes.
that, because as a body coming together, you know, when I was at Howard, you know, there was a competition, because either you were Zeta or you were Delta or AKA. And it was big time. And
mm-hmm.
and for that to be put out in the forum and say, you know, well, I need you to compete to be my sister. No, no,
mm-hmm. no.
And I know that that's
no.
not Christian based, but I thank God for being able to come full circle and realizing not only the Word that was in you, but also the commitment, because of where you come from and how
mm-hmm.
long you've been saved and how long you've been seeking the Lord and serving the Lord. It made it that much easier to recognize,
mm-hmm.
first of all, this is truly a woman of the Word, truly a woman of faith. And that no matter what was going on, that you never gave up, and you also never gave up on us, which made
wow.
a big difference. because when you're going through the faith walk, and Pastor Henry, you could chime in when you feel like it, when you're going through the faith walk and you're not sure how to go through it, and then you add parenting to it, and then you add being a wife and a mother to it, we as women somewhere in those schematics, we get lost sometimes because you're wearing so many hats. And you're trying to make sure that, you know, you're dotting every I, crossing every T. But then again, trying to spend time with the Lord, I find it very refreshing to understand that we are allowed to take time for ourselves, to take time in the Word, and realize that that Word and that building of ourselves through the Word can give us that extra oomph to make it through the next situation, be it happy or sad. Me. What do you think, Pastor Henderson?
Yes, I think that is so true, everything that you said. And I was just wanting to chime in on that competition, because so many times when I talk to young women, sometimes they are quick to compare themselves to another person in ministry. Mm-hmm. And I just want to ask the woman of God tonight, what would you tell a young woman who's going into ministry, who believes that they've been called to the pulpit and called to ministry, how to avoid the pitfalls of falling into that spirit of competition and that spirit of feeling like they're not enough, but to just be who God has called them to be? What would you say to that?
Right. I would say, first of all, I know that God wants each and every one of us to be whole, to be healed, and to be free. He wants us to be, an open vessel for him to use. And we can't be that free for him to use us and him to develop us if we're holding things in our hearts. Most of the time, competition comes from hurt, it comes from anger, it comes from, you know, things that we've been through, where we don't have that self-confidence and doing things at all. Once we learn that we all play a part in this body of Christ, we all play a part in what the Lord has for us to do. And once we understand that, sometimes our ministry may not even be behind the pulpit. You know, we all are ministers in Christ. Every believer, everyone that's saved, that comes to know who Jesus is, we're all ministers of the body of Christ. We're all compelled to go into the world to bring souls in. So once we get that understanding and realize that, God can call us to ministry, but it doesn't always have to be a ministry behind the pulpit. So we must find ourselves and find our place in Christ, so that we know where we're supposed to be, that we know which way we want to go. And that calls for a lot of prayer. That calls for a lot of meditation. That calls for a lot of just developing a deeper relationship with God. We have to have that relationship where we know his voice and where we hear his voice. Even when we're praying, even when we're spending time with him, that we know him so well that we know when he is speaking to us. And once we develop that relationship with him, then God will speak to us and we will hear his voice. We will follow the things that, you know, that he says, because the sheep know his voice. So we will know the voice of God and know in that leading. That sometimes people go into ministry just out of what we see. We see somebody great. We see somebody that can bring a powerful word, you know, and make the church go up and all this kind of stuff. And we desire what we see. And we're not really seeking after what the Lord would have
us
to be.
Amen.
Because sometimes we can bring a soul into Christ just by sometimes just giving them a smile, just by giving a hug, just by letting them know that God loves them and stuff. So once we realize that, you know, our place and really where God wants us to be, the different parts of the ministry, there's so many different parts of the ministry. And once we're comfortable in that, you will know what area you're supposed to be working with. Because the things that God gives you to do will come so easy. It like it falls
in
line. Everything just comes. Everything
Amen.
Just comes.
Amen.
You know? And with me, when he puts something in my spirit, I begin to pray on it. I begin to meditate on it. But I do not move until God tells me to move. When he puts me into, tells me to do something, that, because it makes it easy. You don't get tired. You don't feel overworked. You don't feel, you know, you don't feel the stress and the burden of that ministry. Mm-hmm. You just develop that love for it, and you just, you
Thank
go
you,
to
Jesus.
See God even more because you want to know what he's going to do next. What's next?
Yeah.
Amen.
It's important to seek the Lord and develop that relationship.
Amen.
And God may not even tell you in the beginning, but sometimes you'll just find yourself doing things.
Yeah.
And all relating in the same thing. Most of the time, that's where your ministry is. When you feel that desire and you feel that need in a certain area,
Amen.
That's really, you know, the beginning of your ministry and where, you know, where God wants to be. Because you're speaking out of experience, you're speaking out of passion, you're speaking out of a love just for that thing.
Amen.
So my advice to young people going into ministry is to seek ye first the kingdom of heaven.
Yes.
Amen.
God has for you to do.
Yes.
And then all the other things will be added unto you.
That's good. That's good. I had one other question. I wanted to find out what do you see as the barriers that have been in ministry for women? What barriers do you see being broken, you know, for women going into ministries in 2023?
Listen, you see, today we see there are a lot of ministries. There are a lot of women ministries going on. Some of them just do events. People just do initiatives.
Uh-huh.
And then really the lack of people now, I think that the social media has hurt certain things because you don't gather together. You know, everything now wants to be done on Zoom, or they want to have a phone thing. There's nothing like being in the presence.
Come on here. Amen.
Nothing like being in the presence. You can be in the presence and God just moves on you. You can't do that. God can work through the airwaves. I mean, we can hear things
Amen.
And that really minister to us and that really moves us and stuff. But I just think that being in the presence has a stronger effect.
Yes. Amen. Amen.
On the people.
Amen.
Amen. Okay.
You know, and I think it's important to speak from my own experience. Sometimes, especially if you're someone who's dealing with a chronic illness, gathering makes such a difference, and being able to not only see your fellow saints doing praise and worship and possibly even reading the word, but just like you said, just being in the presence of the Lord, that corporate anointing, that corporate worship can take me from a point of pain. Sometimes I'm in so much pain, I'm at a point of tears, that I can sit up in a chair and I can realize that, you know what, God is breathing healing into me at that moment. It doesn't have to be where, you know, someone has laid hands on me. Sometimes that does take place. I'm grateful for it. But there are other times where just the presence and the corporate worship that's going forward brings me comfort and healing. And as we get in his presence and as we further surrender ourselves and allow the Lord to minister to us, I have to agree with you, Pam. It's a moving experience, and it's also an experience that builds your faith. And I'm telling you, the anointing, it destroys the yokes. And I thank God for that, being able to pursue that, you know, because I believe sometimes the enemy of my situation and my sickness is separation and isolation. Mm-hmm. It was very, very difficult for me during COVID, you know, and it was just like, oh my gosh, the silence. I think I've shared this with the both of you before. The silence was so loud it was frightening. Mm-hmm. It almost made me anxious. And I had to learn to, you know, sit down and calm myself and then seek out, you know, there are certain friends that I will call that will pray and will talk. You know, there are a few friends that would stop by. You know, we were masked up and all that. And I had to tell the Lord, I said, I don't understand this. Why am I so bothered? And God was telling me, you know what, you're separating yourself because you have to, but you miss the corporate fellowship. Mm-hmm. And it does. It makes a difference. And I also feel like there's a great time for marinating, so to speak, as you said, Pastor Pam, meditating, mm-hmm. that instantaneous mm-hmm. stuff. And that, you know, I know church is wonderful, and I know it's good, but that microwave stuff, I'm sorry, microwave right. food doesn't taste as good as marinated food. Do you know anybody want to comment on that?
I totally agree. It's just not the same. No matter how you doctor it up, it just doesn't have the same, and it doesn't give you the same nutrients, you know.
Right.
And even
right,
though
amen,
you know,
amen,
yes, it doesn't feed you the same way. Yes, it's something about it. As a woman yes. of God said that when you're in the presence of God, it's something about
mm-hmm.
being in the place
yes.
where He has placed
yes.
His name, where His glory falls, where you have a tangible anointing that you
yes.
that gets involved
yes.
in
yes.
your worship. And that's what we need, and that's what's missing. And for those who are, you know, who have not returned yet back to the fellowship, you know, I just encourage, you know, to move back into
yes.
that place
come.
It's the enemy's job to separate and to isolate
yes.
so that he can
yes.
work his
yes.
work, you know, in your life and to keep you absent from the body of Christ, because we're all connected. We're all connected.
Yes.
The hands
yes.
need the feet.
Yes.
The feet need the eyes. And we all need each other. And
all
that person
amen.
Is absent.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. You're something's missing from the body. So, yeah that instant, because our God is constantly moving. And when you're in one stationary
yes.
place, you're missing a move of God that you wouldn't
yes.
get no other
Hallelujah.
Place than being
Jesus.
In the presence with other believers.
Yes,
because
you know what? I'm still looking for the day when the signs and wonders are going to be there.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
I believe that when we
All
come
right
together,
now.
And when we
yes.
come together
yes.
in one accord and one body,
yes, thank
God
you,
really ma'am. Has to move. There has to be an atmosphere of a
yes.
certain atmosphere that has to be there to take place. From all that, and some of all that you can't do if you separate it, if you're just calling in. But the coming together of everybody being the same mind, on one accord,
yes.
praying for the same
you,
thing,
Jesus.
Speaking those
yes.
same things, you know, looking for
Thank
those
you,
same things that we have this,
yes.
we're on that journey of oneness and on that journey of doing. Miracles have to take place. Deliverances
mm.
have to take place. Those chains have
yes.
to be broken. So there, to
yes.
me,
you,
there's no way that we should go into, we should be in a gathering of such, and you lead the same way you came.
No, no, no. Amen. I agree with you. Amen. No, no. Our God
just,
is a God of change and a God of progress and a God of maturity.
Yes.
And the thing is, As we tap into it, neither one of you can correct me at your will, as we tap into the Lord, as we put self on the shelf and to
yes.
leave it there, and sometimes it's hard. Sometimes I have to go back and say, you know what, check yourself. Do you really want this? Do you really know what you're seeking for? And if you're really going to be mm-hmm. serious about it, then let's get with God. Leave
yes.
the flesh alone. Leave it over there. Stop thinking about the chocolate that's in the refrigerator that's calling your name, Lauren, and just go. Go with God. Because it's more
yes.
of a benefit from me spending time with him and me seeking him out than me eating that piece of chocolate and getting an instant, you know, satisfaction of sugar or high that's going to be gone in 10 or 15 minutes. Y'all pray for me when it comes to chocolate. Amen? Amen.
yes. And that's so good. That's so good because what you did is you turned off the self-centeredness and put the focus back on God. And I think when we turn our focus back away from self-centeredness and put it back on God, we'll see the presence of God come into our midst. because our focus is so divided. You know, everyone's looking at this and looking at that, and God says, I just want you to look at me. I just want you to fall in love with me again.
Yeah.
And I believe that God is calling his church to fall back in love with him, for we have left him on the outside, and he's knocking on the doors of our heart, saying, will you let me come in? I'm the lover of your soul. I love you, and I want to come in. Hallelujah. We done closed the door and left him on the outside. But I believe if we ever open the door and let him come back in and be the center of our life, we will see the power of God manifested like we've never seen it before. Hallelujah. I truly believe it.
I believe it my whole heart. And I thank the Lord because I was laughing. He had given me a message, a title of a message a couple weeks back, but I kind of just wrote it in a notebook and let it go. But I'll eventually let you know when I preach it. God said, will you marry me? Ooh. Will you marry me? Think about it. Hallelujah. I thought I was sister it when, my husband had proposed to me. But I'm like, wait a minute. God proposed to me first. Hello.
Mm-hmm.
Will you marry me?
Yes.
My God actually came and said, will you marry me? How long is that? In spite of what I've done, in spite of where I've been, in spite of what I've eaten, in spite of what I've given out, he forgave me. And then he actually said, Lauren, I'm your God. Will you marry me? Girl, that messed me up. Messed me up. God, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And I believe the Lord just wants That's it. He just wants his bridegroom back. He wants us to be ready. He wants us to be ready. Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes. Mm. He's the bridegroom coming back for his bride. And we, the church, is the bride of Christ. Amen.
Yes.
He's given us time to get ready.
Mm.
Amen. He's given us time that he's gone away. He said, I'm coming back for a church without spot, blemish, wrinkle, or any such thing. He's giving us time to get the blemishes out and the spots out, to get our life unspotted from the world, because he's ready, amen, to be joined back with his bride.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus is the bridegroom, and he's coming back for his church. He's coming back for his bride.
Hallelujah.
He's the church. He's the bride of Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
My. Hallelujah. He's coming soon.
He's waiting.
So, Pastor,
would you love with him again?
Amen.
Because, you know, nowadays, especially with the COVID and especially with, you know, people just not wanting to gather at church, you know, to come to church and stuff, and we would put every other thing before we put God. We'll come up with every kind of excuse.
Forgive
not
me,
to
Lord.
Go to
Amen.
Church,
Amen. Forgive me.
Every kind of excuse not to join in on Bible study, not to join in on prayer. It doesn't matter. It's so easy for people nowadays to just put God on the back burner. And God doesn't want to be on the back burner. He wants to be first, foremost in our lives. All the excuses. I always consider going to church and fellowshipping with God and stuff like, well, what if do you make those excuses about going to your job? Do you make excuses that it's too early to get up and do this? Do you say that when you have to go to do you give your boss all those kind of truths? We'll go to work sick. We'll go to work but we'll go to work. But then come Sunday morning, Friday night, or Wednesday night, Bible study. I don't feel good. My head just hurt me so bad. I just can't get on the line today. I just can't make it to church. With any kind of, and I say, if you went to work that day, then why you can't go to church that night?
Come on.
Amen.
Yes. Our spiritual mother. Amen.
If you press your way, we don't press the way for God the way we do our everyday lives, things in our everyday lives. And that's what God wants to bring us back to. I remember when we were coming up, we had to go to church. They had our shut-ins and everything. We were in on the church. We had to get up the next day sometime and go to school. But we still My grandmother used to say,
amen,
as long as you in the midst, you ain't paying attention, but your ear gate's still here.
Yeah.
Amen. Yes, amen.
In the church. And, you know, a lot of those things that she taught us back then, I use to my advantage now.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Amen. Bless
the
Lord.
As I was thinking about the women's thing and stuff, I was looking up the scripture where it's talking about where the old women are to teach the younger.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
Amen. If we don't have things like this, if you don't have things like women's fellowship and stuff to teach them, then how are they going to learn?
Amen.
If we don't
gather
together, they don't see those examples.
That's right.
If we don't come together.
That's right. And that's so important. And
amen.
I truly believe that's so very important. And the lack of examples, I know that coming up, the mothers played a major role in the church. I mean, their presence was evident, you know, and they held on to the word of the mother, you know, and the mother would be like the elders, you know, you held on to that word because if they spoke a word to you, you know, it was like, you know, this is from God because they were so close to God and you honored their, you honored their reverence to God. And so they would come by you and tell you something, and even though it was a word to maybe tell you to get it right and fly right, you took it because you knew they said it out of love. And you know nowadays,
we don't forget it.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
And
we
and
need
the respect.
That.
We need the respect. The respect was there for the role of the mothers. You know, I've said it before, I didn't come from a church background, but hearing the stories, even from older people that were part of another ministry, the mothers were an integral part. They were at the altar. They're working in the altar. And as Pastor Henderson said, if they came and said something to you, you know what? Get it right. I know where you were last night or whatever, or maybe, you know, God showed me, but guess what? You can get up here and get saved. Call on Jesus. So you feel it. Important directions, tools that were used and help people understand that this salvation thing is for real. And you have to want it for yourself for real. And you have to be committed to the Lord and allow the Lord to change you.
Mm-hmm.
To change you. And I'm telling you, even the respect in my mind, the first thing I remember now about the mothers is that, number one, they had that quiet tone. They never said anything, you know, yelling or screaming at you, but that soft little tone, you know, maybe rub on your back to let you know if they were there, things of that nature. And the respect for that position, I mean, it's like that Sam said, to this day, it's still there. And you'll remember, you know, if she said, you know, honey, you know, your skirt's too tight, you know, or too short, you know, we don't want to, you know, entice anybody or make anybody, you know, think wrong. So let's think about the next time, you know, you get dressed.
Mm-hmm.
And that was it.
Mm-hmm.
And we took something like that. It wasn't
you
know, and yes, there is a reason, or there is a time when you have to come as you are. But as you become a seasoned saint, you should be able, number one, to be corrected, and you should also be able to correct yourself. You know the dress
that's
code.
Right.
You know how you're supposed to present yourself. And that's, you know, that's maturity. But also, thank God for the mothers. Thank God.
Yeah.
Because they're an integral part. Maybe that person doesn't have a mother at home. Or maybe they don't have a relationship with their mother, and they would not receive that correction from their own mother. But when the mothers of the church come to them, and they see that reverential, they see that countenance where they spent time with God, and they give you the scripture and that pleasantry. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'd rather take a chain through pleasantry than you beat me over the head. I'm not good with that. I'm not good with that.
Me neither.
But ladies, as we come to a close, I want to thank you, but I also want to ask Pastor Pam if you can give the invitation to salvation. I would greatly appreciate it.
Amen.
Oh, sure. So with that being said, we're going to ask, if there's anyone that like to know about this God, or would like to become a part of a church or a woman's fellowship or whatever, if you think that's the life that's for you or the life change that you want to make,
thank you, Lord.
I'm asking you, you know, right now that this is an opportunity that we're giving you to make a change in your life. Because I'm telling you, I'm not saying that the world, that the what you're doing, you made it makes you feel good and stuff, because, you know, I did. I was happy with what I was doing. But there's nothing like living for the Lord. It's a whole new type of happiness.
Ooh, so much.
Yes,
And you can find anything that you need there. If you need someone to talk to, there's somebody there for you to talk to. If there's need somebody to pray with you, there's somebody for there that can pray with you. If you need somebody just to be your friend, God knows there's somebody there that just can be your friend. So,
despite
things that people have said against church, or, you know, against women going to church, or women in the church, or people that's been hurt by the church or whatever, I say come and try it for yourself.
Yeah.
Amen.
Come and try it for yourself.
Amen. Amen. It's worth it. It's worth it. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Yeah. And if you left, come on back. Hallelujah.
Amen. That's
come
right.
On.
Amen. Yes, it.
Come on back. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Come on back.
He's a forgiving God. There ain't nothing that you did that will not forgive you for. Nothing.
Come on. Yes.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Nothing.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
Lord. Absolutely.
We thank you, woman of God, for tonight. Yes, hallelujah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
I mean, remember what I really can't believe all the years that have gone by, but to understand how awesome God is and how he has developed each of us and how he has given us different areas to minister to each other and also to minister to our community, because it's one thing to be of the community and then to be in the community, to see that there is such a need. You know, as a classroom teacher, I didn't understand until I really started learning some of the students, you know, what is going on at home directly affects their behavior in the classroom.
Yes.
And I bet you to say what is going on at home directly affects behavior in the church. If you're living one way at home and then you're living a different way when you go to church, you know, kids are very smart. Kids are not as innocent or ignorant, I should say, as some people think. They watch us. Even the children in the church, they watch us.
And they
can mimic us. They can tell you who shouts like this, who yells like that. You know, different situations. And they'll tell it. They'll tell it whether you're living right or not. Yes. Not that you want it to be that way, but let's think about the image that we're presenting or the example that we're presenting in front of our children. And how would Christ judge us? What would he say about our behavior? Because when you're straddling the fence, it's not comfortable. Male or female, it's not comfortable. So I would implore you today, make up your mind.
Church can be that safe place.
Serving the Lord has nothing but benefits. Nothing but benefits.
Yes.
And he's no respecter of person. As Pastor Pam and Pat Henderson said, he'll forgive you for everything. And you don't need to tell Jimmy, Bob, and Sally Sue. All you got to do is tell Jesus.
Exactly.
He'll forgive you.
That's
and he'll take you back. He'll take you back.
Probably.
So as we leave out this note this evening, I want to thank Pastor Henderson and Pastor Pam. I greatly appreciate you, women of God. I greatly appreciate your ministries and also your faithfulness. And your friendliness and the love that you have shown me, it has given me encouragement. It has kept me. And there are times when my tears have been dried because I remember what has been said to me, encouraging words. And I thank you for that. And I just want you to know that, you know, it means a lot to have sisters who are true sisters, who care about you, who love you, who won't pet you up. Don't pet me up with my phone. My flesh may hurt, but I don't want to be wrong, because when I stand before God and he says, well, didn't they tell you? I'm like, well, I didn't think they meant it. You know what? The word, it cuts and restores. It cuts and restores. And I'd rather be cut and restored than left just to die. And I thank you both for that. I thank you both for that. All right, Pastor Henderson, you got to pray us out. Amen, amen.
Amen, amen. We thank God for you as well. Elder Brown, we thank God for what God is doing in your life and your faithfulness.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
The best is yet to come.
Amen. We thank our guest tonight.
You,
amen. Thank you, woman of God. And we know something was said
amen.
Tonight that
Woo-hoo.
Was heard in the ears of the listeners that's making a difference. And we thank God for you tonight.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you and we praise you. We
thank
give
you, Lord.
You glory and we
yes,
give you
Lord.
Honor, Father God. We thank you for what you are doing in our lives. We thank you for
thank
the
you,
women
Lord.
That have left
thank
impact
you.
In our lives. We
yes,
thank you for
Lord.
The
thank
seeds
you,
that have been planted in our lives that's growing up
you,
in
yes,
us,
Lord.
Father God. Lord, we thank you that there
thank
are seeds
you,
that are still laying dormant that were, are
yes.
yet to come forth in us, oh God. For the best is
yes.
yet to be revealed, Father God. Lord, we ask
thank
that you
Lord.
Remember each listener, oh God, tonight. Oh, God, that one, oh, God,
yes,
that's
Lord.
Thriving, that one, hallelujah, that's trying to survive. But, God, help them to see
yes,
that you are their answer, that you are
yes.
their strength, you are their peace, and everything they
yes,
need
Lord.
To grow, everything they need to be
yes,
successful,
Lord.
It is
thank
all
you,
found
Jesus.
In you. And so, Father God, in
yes,
the name
Lord.
Of Jesus, we thank you,
yes.
oh, God, for this word tonight,
thank
this
you,
discussion
Jesus.
Tonight. And we thank you, oh, God, that you are causing the seed of your word to manifest
yes.
in our
yes,
lives,
Lord.
To bring us,
thank
oh, God, into
Lord.
That expected end, to grow us up and to develop us, that
yes,
we will have fruit that other people can eat from, that they may grow and know you as Lord and Savior. Thank you for this opportunity.
Yes.
Thank you for the woman of God and the women of God tonight. Thank you, hallelujah,
mm-hmm.
for Bishop Richard
thank
on
you,
tonight. Amen. And family
amen.
Tonight, we thank you tonight for what
bless
you are
Lord.
Doing. Continue to have your way in our lives. We surrender to you, Lord.
Yes.
We say yes to your will.
Yes.
Let your will
yes.
be done.
Yes, Lord.
Let your kingdom come. In Jesus' name
yes,
we
Lord.
Pray. Amen.
Yes,
and amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Amen and amen. Awesome. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Play the outro or the exit, please. Ladies, love you. With the love of the Lord, shalom, shalom.
Love you. Yes, God.
Love you. Shalom, shalom.
Amen.
Amen.
You've been listening to Open Mic with Bishop Ernest E. Richard and Company. If this podcast has been a blessing to you, then please consider sowing into this ministry. A $20 gift or more would be appreciated. You can do so through Cash App. Just use $Power to Stand or on PayPal, Pritchard719@gmail.com. On behalf of Bishop Richard and the Open Mic panel, I'm Nina Taylor saying have a blessed week. We'll see you soon.